how we can describe even nuclei, especially using dynamical symmetries. We have seen how we can do that in odd even nuclei or even together in supersymmetries, dynamical supersymmetries. And now we go for the real hard stuff, odd nuclei. So we consider now that we have an odd proton and an odd neutron. Now, why is this stuff real hard? Just look at the level densities. Up to 400 keV in a standard O6 nucleus, I have one excited state, the 2+, and the ground state 0+. I have maybe 10 states or more. Even platinum, we had more than 10 states, if I remember, up to this energy in an odd A nucleus. But I will have about 50 states up to 500 kiloelectron volt in an odd nucleus, because now I can couple the spin of the proton with the spin of the neutron fermion with the spin of the boson core, and so this becomes really complex from the experimental side also. So let's first start by introducing the neutron-proton degree of freedom and supersymmetry. So a combination of F-spin, which you saw yesterday in Norbert Pietralla's lecture, with the Bose-Fermi symmetry in the first instance. So now we consider that we have proton bosons and neutron bosons, and they are acting separately, only protons among protons and neutrons among neutrons. Then we have this product group of U proton 6 and U neutron 6, and the number of protons and the number of neutrons is fixed. Now we can extend that to a product of two superalgebras, a protonic 6MP times U 6M nu. And then we have the super ereps N pi, the sum of the number of proton fermions and bosons, and N nu, the sum of the number of neutron fermions and bosons fixed. So we have a product of these two groups. If we take our matrix representation to get a feeling what is happening, then we have here two sectors, one supersymmetric sector with the bosonic and the fermionic generators. We have sectors having zero, and then here we have the same for the neutrons. The product group defines a so-called extended supersymmetry and will be used to describe also odd nuclei in this lecture. Now, if we now embed this group by filling also in the zero of diagonal sectors, we have a U12 m pi plus m nu supersymmetry, which mixes not only the bosons and the fermions, but also the neutron and the protons, fermions and bosons. And so this will have a super ereps equal to the sum of n pi and n nu. And it has, when we go back, it's clear that this, if we have filled this with generators of the appropriate type, changing neutrons and protons, that if we take the subset of matrices which have here zero, that we have a subgroup, and that's a reduction from the upper U12 m pi plus m nu supergroup to the product of the proton and the neutron supergroups. Now, I just take an example, which is a part of it, because we, for the protons, we don't have a supersymmetry. You can have supersymmetries in the xenon region of the spinor type, which are in this sense that you have now an odd neutron which can occupy 1/2, 3/2, 5/2, and 7/2 orbits. So the total dimension is then 20. And so if we now do this embedding of the supergroups, then we have U12/20 going to U proton 6 and the supersymmetry U620. And then the sum from n of both is a constant, where this always can be bosons, this can be bosons and boson plus a neutron. So here you see that for the even-even, this is equivalent to something which is called an F-spin multiplet, which was shown by Norbert in his lecture, but now it's a kind of supersymmetric extension of an F-spin multiplet. So as an example, here you get now one spectrum for one super EREP at this level, and you can compare this spectrum with spectra in even-even, tellurium, nuclei, 126, but also 130 xenon, 134 barium, 138 cerium. And if you look, like we saw yesterday in another case, the energies in these nuclei are very similar. Many of these energies were known are very similar to this F-spin supersymmetric multiplet prediction. Then you can continue for 124 tellurium and 122 tellurium and the associated here even up to samarium. So again, in this description you have one spectrum for the even-even and you compare it to many different nuclei. Now, because it's a supersymmetry, you can do now the same also for the odd A nuclei. So this is the double physical, so it means 3/2 ground state, 1/2 first excited state, 5/2. So this is the associated supersymmetric prediction for the odd A telluriums, xenons, bariums, and ceriums up to neodymium here for N equals 6 and N equals 7 up to samarium again. And you see generally a good agreement. Look at this multiplet, that's always the same. It only changes here in the very far away nuclei. The same happens here. It's closely spaced and here it's inverted. And so it's also in the data inverted. In the afternoon, we will have some exercises on this kind of S-spin multiplets also. Now, F-spin symmetric extended supersymmetries, what does it mean? What we want to have is a product of a supersymmetry for protons and a supersymmetry for neutrons. And we want to do in the reduction a F-spin combination at the U boson level of the prosonic neutron boson generators and proton boson generators, similar as we do it in the F-spin symmetric limits of the IBM2. So then we get this group. And this group, now we want to combine at a certain level with the fermionic groups. Now, why do we first introduce an F-spin symmetric extended supersymmetry? It's a practical reason. Because if we do this combination of the boson groups at the U6 level, then you have seen with Norbert, and you will see in exercises, you have this F max states, the symmetric states, and they are exactly the same as in the IBM1. Now we want to describe odd nuclei, and of course we don't want to describe odd nuclei at excitation energies of 2 MeV, where you have this mixed symmetry states occurring, because there's nothing, and really nothing known about odd nuclei at 2 MeV. It's very hard to know up to 500 kiloelectron volt. And by doing this combination, we can now restrict ourselves to the F equals 0 states. Small f is n divided by 2 minus big F of Norbert. So we will use that also in the exercises. So it means the symmetric states, because here we have no second label. So we have just n, 0. For the numerical calculations of states in the odd nucleus. Yeah? So in practice, we don't need in the numerical calculations to make a distinction between neutron and proton bosons. And this reduces our configuration dimensions in a very large amount. Now, the first example of such a symmetry was the neutron U612 cross proton U64 extended supersymmetry. So here you see the chain which was worked out. It concerns the O6 limit. So here you're going to the O6 limit of the combined system. This is already combined at the level with the neutrons at the level of U6 here. And then you can use now the similarity or isomorphism of the spinor symmetry with the O6 symmetry, and then you have a double combination. In this case, you have boson plus fermion for neutron and protons, both. And then you continue over this spin 5, spin 3, to spin 3 level. So it's a mixture of the pseudo-spin symmetry for the neutrons and the spinor type symmetry for the protons. Now, if you start from the two super ellipses, then you know that in this super ellipse you can have a number of bosons and a number of fermions, and a number of protons and a number of proton fermions. And the super reduction rule says that the total number of bosons plus fermion for each type is conserved. Now, the advantage of combining both is that I now can have the situation that n nu is I have a value n nu with m nu being 0 and m pi being 0, then I have an even nucleus. M nu being 1, m pi being 0, then I have an odd neutron nucleus. M pi being 1 and m nu being 0, then I have an odd proton nucleus. And the case also m nu and m pi not being 0, but both being 1 or even higher. And then if both are 1, I describe an odd nucleus. The supersymmetric condition says then that the Hamiltonian in all these four systems is given by Casimir operators in a general way. They are realized differently because sometimes the neutron fermion generators are not present, or the proton fermion are not present, but the mathematical algebraic structure of the Hamiltonian is given by these group chains, and the parameters AY are constant not only for two nuclei, but they are constant for four nuclei. So we will do a big economy in the number of parameters compared to the number of states we will describe. So, how does it work? So, we have a physically relevant Hamiltonian. It has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 parameters. Ends up, of course, with the J value or the L value. It has quantum numbers, which are generally, we need 3 quantum numbers now in order to describe such complex systems. So these are the eigenfunctions are described as a function of these quantum numbers. Which quantum numbers are contained within the higher IREPS is given by the reduction rules, which are known. We get an analytic eigenvalue in function of these 6 parameters as a function of these quantum numbers of these eigenfunctions. We have a Hamiltonian, which is made out of algebraic form in Casimir operators, which will generate the boson-boson interaction, the boson-fermion interaction, and also the neutron-proton-fermion interaction. Now, suppose we start from the even-even nucleus. This has n pi bosons and n nu bosons. Now, some of the terms, like this term, will have the same quantum number, so they will just add up. Of course, as we saw before, O3 and spin3 will have the same quantum number, so they will just add up. And so we have as parameters B prime plus B, C, D plus E. So 3 parameters to describe the even-even nucleus.
Maybe you can change the battery.
Yes.
I will see. battery is low.
Ah, yeah, okay.
I will do that.
Yes. And also the first one is the first one in the even is only, it has only the representation n comma 0 0, and so it's the same for all states. It's only contributing to the ground state energy. So that's also for the excited level scheme, not a relevant parameter. But nevertheless, three combinations of the parameters can be determined in the even nucleus. And now I act with the U612 supersymmetry, take out one neutron boson, so I have one neutron boson less, and I have a neutron fermion occupying 1/2, 3/2, or 5/2 orbit. Now, if I do that, I still have that those quantum numbers are the same, because the difference between this group and this group is that I have added here the proton, and so that's not the case in our odd neutron nucleus. And so we have now the combinations A is relevant, B prime plus B, C, D, E, so I have five parameters, which I can determine in the odd neutron nucleus, like platinum 195 we discussed before. But I can also act now by transforming one proton boson in a proton fermion occupying a 3/2 orbit. Then again, I have four parameters, some linear combinations, which can be used to fit the spectra. And finally, I can now act again by transforming again one neutron boson in a neutron fermion, and I end up in an odd-odd nucleus in which all six parameters are relevant, because it's the most complex system. But if you look...
Four nuclei.
Six parameters for four nuclei of three different types. Yeah, so that's the idea. But if you look carefully, then you see if I measure the odd A nuclei and the even, I can also determine the six parameters. And that was the idea we had in the beginning. If we fit the other members, we can predict the spectrum of the odd-odd nucleus, and that's an excellent test to test whether this dynamical symmetry, supersymmetry, is valid in nature, so to say. Now, the first point is where to apply this. This we have studied already. We know that we need the O6 limit, and that's here platinum region, the best examples. And we need a 1/2, 5/2, and 3/2 neutron orbits, and a proton orbit with D 3/2. So this will be the region to apply. The four nuclei, which are often called a magic quartet, the term is from Franco Iacello, have the best candidates are given here, so platinum 194, platinum 195, because it's the best example of U612, which we studied before, then gold 195, gold 196, or platinum 196, which is the best example of O6, together with 197, 197 platinum in gold, and gold 198, or iridium 193, which is one of the best examples of U64, and there the odd nucleus would be iridium 194. So if we study the three nuclei, we get predictions for the negative parity states in gold 198, 196, and iridium 194. So what we have studied are, in fact, the first three of these four candidates over the last many years. Now, the first candidate was gold 198. Now, this is natural gold. It's monoisotopic. It's very strange, but gold is one of the cheapest targets you can have in nuclear physics, because you don't need an isotopic enrichment. 197 gold is monoisotopic, sorry. Dus 198 gold you can reach by using the N-gamma reaction, thermal neutron capture, or by using the DP transfer reaction. And those experiments were done, N gamma was done in several experiments over the years, and the DP reaction was also done in München and in Orsay. Now, first, here I plot again this magic square, starting from 196 platinum, and then we have U612 in this direction and U64 in this direction. Now, this is from the original work in which the extended supersymmetries were proposed. We have fitted here the six parameters, all in kiloelectron volts, and here is a comparison between the experimental. I don't know why it fades always away. If I keep, yeah, no, it is there an option? No, anyhow. No. Yeah. Okay. So we start from platinum 196 as a good example of 06. So that's here the fit. Then we have 197 platinum, where you have this doublet structure which you can fit, and then you obtain this agreement. Then we have gold 197 with the 3.5, and then here a 1.5, 3.5, 5.5, which you can fit. But here the knowledge on states was already more limited experimentally. Worse, yeah.
I think they put the used batteries back in the box.
Ah, okay. Yeah. So, and there was some knowledge on low-lying states in gold 196, so 198. So this was not completely a prediction. So taking those also account in a least square fit, we obtain this kind of description for the gold. You have to take care of the different energy scales here. The both are up to 500 kiloelectron volts. Here they are up to 2 MeV and 1 MeV. Yeah, let's try it again. On the other hand, like what was the case for platinum 195 before, there are many other levels with uncertain spins and parities which could not be included in the fit, or could not be clearly assigned to the theoretical predicted levels. And because of that, several experiments were performed over the years, which I shortly present. One is this arc measurement. I don't know whether Rick told you about that. That was in the time that Rick was still in Brookhaven. So it's a trick in order to determine spins or different values of spins. So that was performed, and that showed that some of the spins were wrong, so had to be reassigned to other experimental levels. So this is experimental result. These are the theoretical results. So we needed some new assignments. Then branching ratios were used, and also with the branching ratios, you had to flip these 2, 3 minus states because the branching didn't agree. Compared to the theory, and transfer was performed, DP transfer reactions were performed in Orsay, and also there the assignment had to change because you now have transfer reaction amplitudes. Here you have the supersymmetric description, that's the experimental results, and then you can do a microscopic interacting boson-fermion fermion model calculation, and that's these results without supersymmetry. Yes?
So
yeah. Yeah. No, protons have 1.5 orbit closed, then the 3.5 orbit, and then the unique parity orbit, and hash 11.5. Let me go back. So for the protons, this is the relevant orbit. For the neutrons, you have 3. Yeah. We will come to that. We will see that we will see at a certain energy some S1.5 transfer. I will come to that. Yeah. So So the conclusion of this paper, if you look at the resulting energy spectrum, it's not really very good. And if you look at the parameters used and you say, okay, I have this kind of as an original fit with a few levels with known spin and parities, I have these parameters, but then it turns out in the first experiment you have to change the parameters here, the second experiment you have to change the parameters here and here, in the final experiment you have to change again the parameters, although here it's a lot in D. So it means that it's not really, you can say that this is a good prediction. Yeah. So the conclusion of this paper was, if it thus appears that extended supersymmetry, however elegant in its formulation, can give but a description of global properties of gold 198, such as the level density, and even that only with certain limitations due to a restricted single particle space. A detailed level-by-level description of the odd-odd nucleus is more difficult to obtain, but at present no other model seems available that can more adequately describe odd-odd nuclei in this region. So that was a little bit the end of GOLD 198 description in extended supersymmetry. However, let's go over to the second candidate, which is 196 GOLD. Again, we have these six parameters, and I list here again which parameters you can determine in the different nuclei. Now we start with 94 platinum. We have this very well described 195 platinum, 195 gold, and then we get 196 gold. Now, in this case, we really follow the rule that we predict the spectrum of the odd-odd nucleus by having the spectrum of the other partners. And when we started this business, that was 1985 or 1989, I made the first prediction, you looked at the experimental level scheme of 196 gold. Here you see it, here below 500 MeV. Here you see the ground state is a 2 minus state. All the other states are positive parity states, because they could be identified by their isomeric decay. And then we have a 12 minus state above 500 keV. There is no experimental negative parity state known. We expect about 50 of them. Nevertheless, because we have the possibility to fit the Hamiltonian to the other three nuclei, we can determine the six parameters. And here you see the prediction of how the negative parity states should be in this odd-odd nucleus. First thing which is apparent, we also don't predict the ground state, because the ground state is a 1 minus 2 minus doublet. And it's known, the sequence is not correct, because the ground state is known to be a 2 minus. So, but nevertheless, we see that we have a density of states in the model which we then have tested in the years afterwards. One thing important to remark, this 12 minus is the combination of the two unique parity orbits. Yeah? So it is not in our model space, but you can show by certain, for odd-odd you have a kind of parabolic rules, you can show or that the 12 minus state, which is the highest state which can be combined, that this is the lowest state of the combination of the unique parity. Yeah? So we assume that below 500 MeV, kilo electron volt, there are no combinations of negative parity made from the I13½ and the H12½, which also leads to negative parity states. So that was the situation in 1989 and the theoretical prediction for 196 gold. And it took about 10 years to verify this prediction. Now the first thing to do is transfer reactions, because the DT reaction, so you shoot with deuterons and you get tritons out, So you have transferred one neutron, so were performed on gold 197. And what you see here is the experimental spectrum. From the angular distribution, you can determine which states are negative parity and which states are positive parity. And so here you have the measured negative parity spectrum. The ground state is here, and then 500 MeV is here. And indeed, we see many peaks, indicating that there are many still unassigned or unobserved negative parity states in gold 196 below 500 MeV. Now, because spectroscopic factors could not be extracted from this experiment, what we have done, we have convoluted at a certain angle, 15 degrees, our theoretical values with the DBBA calculations. And so from the calculated spectroscopic factor, we can now generate also a theoretical experimental spectrum. And the next thing we can then test is we go in energy from 0 up to 1,000, and we make a running sum of the experimental values, summed values of the spectroscopic strength, and we compare that with the theoretical values of the spectroscopic strength. One problem is there were not enough data to distinguish the different orbits. Yeah, but we made this running sum. Now the conclusion was that although the spectra look a little bit different, the running sums are very similar. They go up to 500 and then they saturate in the theory. You have some graphs adding up, but it's maybe 15% of what you see here. And also the onset is very similar. In 1993, Orsay experiments, the other one was in Garkin, allowed to distinguish between L equal 1 and L equal 3. Yeah, so here experimentally, you could now see these states have L equal 1 transfer, these states have L equal 3 transfer. If you compare it with supersymmetry, you get this value. So that's not very, very well described if you compare it like that. But you can try to break supersymmetry. That was tried by moving this 1 minus state higher up to here. So you break supersymmetry, and then you get a better description of the data. However, the resolution in energy in Orsay was not very good. So the point is that these states, which are in disagreement, or the non-occurrence of this state, can be due to doublets or triplets. And so you measure a strength, but you're measuring the strength of two states, which are very closely spaced, instead of one state. In order to do that, new studies were started on gold 196 of the same type as I told you before. So transfer, PD, and then also with polarized beam. But now on the odd-odd nucleus, towards the odd-odd nucleus. Again, we used the Q3D spectrometer in Garching with its amazing energy resolution of 6 keV, we were able to show that indeed the ground state in the transfer experiment is a doublet. And the doublet has a spacing of 6 kilo electron volt. Yeah? So that could not be resolved in Orsay. And we saw many more new states forming doublets in the original transfer experiments. They are all given here in red boxes. All these red box states are resolved doublets in this beautiful transfer spectrum, where again the background is zero in between the peaks. Okay, it's 10 But here we're talking about 10,000 counts. Yeah. And we did also the polarized experiment, which allows you now to get the transferred spin. So you can determine from this analyzing powers whether it's a combination of P or 3/2 and so on. So we have the neutron transfer as P 1/2, P 3/2, F 5/2. So we can determine whether it's P or whether it's a mixture of different orbits. Now, why is this important? The situation is a little bit more complicated in this case, because we start from an odd A nucleus, which has a spin 3/2 plus. Experimentally, we can determine what is the content of the transferred particle to a state. Let's take one example. If the final state is 2 minus, then the transferred intensity can contain one part of P 1/2, one part of P 3/2, and one part of P 5/2. They all can make a 2 minus state. If the transfer is pure F 5/2, then we can argue that most likely we are populating a 4 minus state. Yeah, because this cannot be populated by the other ones. If the transfer is purely P 3/2, we can argue that this is most likely a 0 minus state, because it doesn't show the other transfers. If it's only P 3/2 and F 5/2, we can argue that this is most likely a 3 minus, but if we observe also a P 1/2 component, then we can argue it's 1 minus or 2 minus. And also in the data you see here, you have different contributions. You don't have pure transfer necessary. In order to solve this problem, or to try to find out that the thing is consistent, a very difficult experiment was done by the München group. This was using a transfer reaction in which the final particle is an alpha particle, and you start with a deuteron on an even nucleus, which is 198 mercury. Then you don't have this problem, because the even nucleus has a 0 plus ground state. If you measure the art of transfer particle, you know at the end you can determine the spin uniquely. Also because alpha particles have spin 0. Yeah, it's also a spin 0 particle. The price to pay is the intensity. You see the maximum reduced from 10,000 to 100. The second problem is the energy resolution, because you know that the stopping power of alpha particle in material is very big, and now you have to get the alpha particle after the transfer reaction out of the target without too much loss of energy. So that's very difficult, so you have to use very thin mercury targets. Yeah, but still you have some energy struggling, but now you know from the PD reaction where the states are, for instance here 0 and 6 keV, they form a kind of potato. But having the knowledge, you can fit a boat in a double peak fit and extract from that the transfer strength. You can do it, to make it even more difficult, using polarized beam. And then you see here the spectra with spin up and spin down is in red. And you really see that there are large changes. Look at these two peaks. It's reduced 50% with spin up. It's increased or doubled here with spin up. Yeah. So from the spectra you see here also clearly different behaviors. And that's of course very important information in order to extract knowledge on the states. Now, here are examples of the cross-sections for different states. and the analyzing powers for different states here, or cross sections analyzing powers. Now you have a ground state of 0 plus, and then you have, of course, that the deuteron has a spin 1. So you have to combine the deuteron transfer with the nucleon transfer to a total J transfer, and then you end up in a state with J and parity minus L for the transfer. Now it turns out that in the combinations you can work it out, and you can get 17 safe spin assignments from this experiment in 196 gold below 500 keV. More states are observed, but you cannot do this for all states. And because of that, you can test your hypothesis which you used before, and you can fix some spins and parities using the alpha, the d alpha reaction. And this is the outcome from the experiment. Before known was only a 2 minus ground state. And now we know it's a 6 keV doublet of a 1 minus and a 2 minus. This is the original prediction, 1 minus, 2 minus, so that's very good, in fact. Yeah? Although it looked worse, it's very good. And then these are the up to 600, we observe many, 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 many states. New of negative parity, and we can assign for many Shor spin and parities. Some are in brackets still, but many have unique spin and parity assignments. And in order to test this, of course, we look at the transfer reaction amplitudes, strengths here as a function of energy for P1/2 transfer, P3/2 transfer, F5/2 transfer to 1 minus states. These are the 1 minus states. The same here for 2 minus states, same here for 3 minus states, where you cannot have a P1/2 transfer. What you see here are the experimental values compared to the theoretical ones. And so it's possible to identify more or less many of the states, so you can assign the quantum numbers of the states. You see these dashed lines, that's how the states are identified. So as I said, this work took about 10 years, the verification of the original prediction. Now, at the same time, you can do in-beam spectroscopy, in which you now do another kind of reaction, a fusion evaporation reaction. So contrast to a direct reaction, the proton is captured, for instance, stays up to 10 to the minus 16 seconds in the compound nucleus, and then some evaporation, for instance, of a neutron is happening, and you get then the de-excitation by conversion electrons and gamma emission. Now, these in-beam experiments were done at three places. We measured gamma rays and conversion electrons. Conversion electrons are very important in heavy odd-odd nuclei. Yeah? Mostly, transitions go by conversion electrons in many cases. And that we did using the D2N reaction at the Philips cyclotron of the Paul Scherrer Institute in Switzerland. And we used for the PN reaction, which has a higher, a smaller cross section. PN has a higher. This was used at the Bond cyclotron and at Yale, at the then still existing tandem accelerator, using the IRAS ball. So here you see examples of the PN reaction at 9 MeV. I'm wondering, I think this should be, I know, no, This is the small cross section. This reaction has about 1 barn cross section. Now, why we use this cross section? Because site reactions like P2N or TN or D3N are not populated. And so you get very clean spectra. If you look, if you go to a higher energy with a higher cross section, then you see here P2N reactions become dominant. Yeah? So you have to well choose your energy. Here is an example of conversion electron spectra. And you really see that this conversion electron spectra, as a function of the momentum of the electrons, show many, many, many peaks, because we are dealing with odd-odd nuclei. Now, the results for the lowest state from the in-beam work, and again, you cannot read it, but the highest state here is 405 kiloelectron volt. Yeah? So you see there are enormous amounts of states. There are an enormous amount of gamma ray transitions which you have in such an odd-odd system. So that's the result. Further results, and what we found, we have 53 states under 100, 800 keV. 10 new states were observed in the in-beam. 300 transitions, spin and parity limitations by electromagnetic decay could be determined. So that was, there was one PhD by Alexander Metz on the transfer experiment. There was one PhD by Jochen Kreuger on the in-beam work. So the final result, as a function of the 6 parameters, you have a dynamic of symmetry, so every state in the 6 nuclei has quantum numbers. And so this is the final result. On the same scale, in the even-even nucleus, of course, we took more states higher up. But just to present the increasing complexity, when you go from the even-even up to 800 keV, to the odd neutron, to the odd proton, and to the odd-odd nucleus. So you could, we could describe this with 6 parameters, mainly as a prediction. The prediction changed because we found out, I didn't mention that. I mentioned that in platinum 195, in the old fit, an important state had spin 1/2 or 3/2 minus. And it was taken in the theory to be 1/2 minus. From our transfer experiments, we found out that the spin is not 1/2 minus, but 3/2 minus. So we had to adapt the fit again, because this level is important to determine some of the parameters. I will come to that. So more transfer reactions experiments have been done since 2000 on into 196 gold. One is you do proton transfer from platinum 195 into gold 196. This is a 3 helium D reaction. And the interesting part is because, platinum has spin 1/2 plus. And so we now transfer S 1/2 D 3/2. And D3/2 is what we have in our symmetry, U6/4. We don't consider the S1/2 orbit. And so by doing this transfer, we can now also extract S1/2 strength in order to test whether our restricted model space is valid. And this is what you see here. As a function of energy, again as a running sum, the strength for P3/2 going like that and then saturating here as we saw before, and the strength for S1/2, and you see it's small, even more or less continuous here, and then suddenly at 900 keV it suddenly increased and becomes important. Yeah, so it means that the breaking more or less of the S1/2 coupled to zero is only important at high energies, much more higher than we compare the theory with the experiment. Nevertheless, these small contributions were important because they, of course, help to limit the spin values starting from a 1/2 initial state. It can only populate a 0 or a 1. Now, also, the other reaction, alpha D, was done from 194 platinum to 196 gold by Wirth and Friedrich Wirth et al. And now we start again from an even nucleus into the odd odd nucleus, and the transfer reaction, now using an alpha beam, had only a cross section of 5 microbar, so it's very, very difficult reaction. And the final result of all these experiments is here given. So some of the things which were in brackets are not anymore in brackets. I think one state changed spin. And so we now compare that with the theory. And 21 out of the 27 states have now safe spin assignments below 500 keV. Now, as I said, the essence is that it's a prediction from supersymmetry, and so we have to look at the parameters A, B, B prime, C, D, E, describing all extracted from 3 nuclei and describing all 4 nuclei. The prediction in 1989 were these values. As I said, an important state changed its assignment because it was wrongly assigned in 1989, and so that causes here these changes from 62 to 51, from minus 2 to 7. And the final result in 2000 is very similar to the prediction. There are some at the LL and JJ level, there are some changes, but it's very small. So this is without and with gold 190. The total number of states described by these 6 parameters is 8 in the even, 43 in the odd A, 27 in the odd odd. So 43 plus 8 is 51. That makes 51. 78 states described as 6 parameters in 4 different nuclei. Yes? Yes? No. No, no, this is this is without the S1/2. But we have used the S1/2 to fix experimentally spins, to limit spins. Yeah. So that's what I mean. Although it's not in the model space, it's still useful. Yes, yeah. It's still the theoretical calculation is only considered a D3/2 proton. Yes. But to describe 78 states with 6 parameters in 4 different nuclei is certainly an achievement, and that's why I call this the golden gold platinum region. And so we have these quartets which we have investigated. One doesn't work so well, but this one with 196 gold works quite well. Now, can the quartet be extended is a question. In principle, yes. We can now transform another boson into a fermion. And so then we have considered the case where we transform 2 proton bosons into 2 proton fermions and couple the 5 neutron bosons to it. Now, there is an ambiguity which fortunately does not exist in this region. If I would do it for the neutrons, then I would have a description of an even nucleus as a function of neutron bosons and then 2 neutron fermions. So the question is, can you do that? Because you treat some paired nucleons as bosons and some as fermions. So maybe these are higher lying broken pair states. Now, in the case of mercury, this does not occur because this is a closed shell, tin. And if I take a fermion calculation, I can couple two fermions to a closed shell, proton fermions to a closed shell, and describe the excited, normal excited state spectrum. So that's why we can use now, here we now have two fermions, and we can couple the two fermions to U64 symmetry and calculate on all these reduction rules. And we describe not gold 195, but mercury 196. So also here, experiments have been done, alpha 2N in Köln, in also using Iris Ball in Yale, this P3N reaction, and followed by beta decay to 196 gold. And for 198 gold, the both reactions were done, once again, fusion evaporation and beta decay experiment in Köln. This formed the PhD thesis of Christian Bernards in 2011. So the theoretical prediction you obtain now in two proton fermions coupled to five neutron bosons is this one. And you see you have this kind of mixed symmetry states here, but now they are formed using explicit neutron fermions. And this is a result of the experiment. It's not really in an extended supersymmetry description anymore, because there are more and more vibrational characters, because you're so close to the lead isotopes. So I was wrong before, it's lead isotope, not tin isotopes. But nevertheless, you could do a calculation with three parameters describing mercury in the extended supersymmetry. This is the case for 198, mercury, also three parameters, and you have this reasonable good agreement between theory and where known experiments. Still, there are some uncertain spin assignments here, also here. These are candidates for this kind of mixed symmetry states experiment. These four in this tree.
So somehow, so you have your model predictions, for example, you have some number of proton bosons,
yeah,
some neutron bosons, and let's say one fermion left,
mm-hmm,
protons, for example. It, you might say, okay, I don't like the IBA. The IBA approximation is not so good. Let's break one of the pairs.
Yes.
And treat them as not as a boson, but as two fermions.
Yes, but that are.
But this game does stop somewhere.
No, that is done. This kind of broken pair calculations in even nuclei, but they correspond to this kind of excited states at higher energy, because you need some energy.
You break a pair so you can.
Yeah.
Go,
yeah. But in this case, there is no ambiguity because you are closed shell for the protons. Yeah. So they are considered. In fact, it has been done in detail by Vretenar before he started relativistic calculations, and he wrote a code in order also to describe high spin physics using these broken pairs. But it was not used extensively by experimentalists, so he went into another field, in relativistic calculations. Okay. Now you can invert it, and you can go back and look at the predictions from the fit of 196 mercury for 195 gold and 194 platinum. And so here, these are the theoretical values. These are the data. So you fit here 196 mercury, and then you look at the predictions for the other ones. And you see there are some problems, especially here, the splitting, which you predict is much too small compared to the data. So it's not really an extended supersymmetry anymore. There is another example which was studied by Balotus and the München group, and also worked on by the Mexican group around Rudolf Baiker quite a lot, by Barea, which is iridium 194, which was measured by Balotus. This measurement took 20 years. Our measurement took 10 years, but this analysis, I'm sure, took 20 years. And so what comes out of this experiment is here, the experimental level scheme shown here. You can look at the details if you have the slides. And this is the calculated level scheme using extended supersymmetry. Also, the agreement is good, but there is a hic to it. This is the experimental 193 iridium, that's also good, the calculated one, also using a 6-parameter Hamiltonian. The problem is not in osmium 192, there you have also quite good example of O6 symmetry, but the problem is in osmium 193, because the experimental level scheme is here, and it starts with a 3½-1½ doublet, followed by a 3½-5½ doublet, while in the theory, oh no, I'm going in the wrong direction. Yeah. While in the theory, the ground state is a 1½, like U612, and then there is a 3½-5½ doublet and a 1½-3½ doublet. So it's not what is seen in the experiment. And most likely this is because this nucleus is becoming deformed. And so the O6 condition underlying the model is not anymore fulfilled. Nevertheless, it has to be said that the transfer strength for the platinum to iridium 194 reaction are very well described in the model. So here you compare calculated transfer and experimental for different states. And there is a good agreement by the transfers. This presents the, again, complicated experiment, polarized deuterons and alpha go out from an even into the odd nucleus. And you see there is a wealth of data which was measured in this nucleus by Hans Friedrich. So I come to my, I will finish a little bit earlier than normal. I come to my general conclusions. Symmetries, whether they are dynamical or fundamental, are an essential tool to guide us through the complex behavior of the atomic nucleus, or I could even say to the physics in general. So they are tools. Important is they provide benchmarks and robust predictions which experiments can directly verify or falsify. And I would say this is why experimentators like Rake or I, we love them. Because it's clear. If you have a selection rule, either you do the experiment and the selection rule is fulfilled or not. If it's fulfilled, the symmetry is probably not so bad a day. If it's not fulfilled, tant pis, as the French say. It's not so that you have to go to a theoretician and you say, these are my experimental data, and then he does a calculation, and then he has agreement with your data or less agreement. Here, it's always clear before. Either I measure it, and it's okay, or I don't measure it, and it's wrong. Symmetries are important also because they lay the basis for perturbative treatments, refining our understanding of the world. There was one question in the lesson of Marc Caprio, why the Davidson potential? Because it's such a phenomenological thing and not microscopically. Now, the Davidson potential has the advantage, it's a complete solution. It has a complete basis. So that means that you can then do more performant calculations, and in fact, that is what David Rowe does, using the Davidson basis states. Yeah? And so, always, if you get an analytic solution and you do the reductions, you have a complete basis. And then you can define any numerical, microscopically based Hamiltonian, like in the IBFM calculations, and use this basis to diagonalize this more semi-microscopical Hamiltonian. So that's an important point. They provide understanding of complex situations. Nobody can read a wave function of a large-scale shell model calculation. I had a student, and she did large-scale Antoine calculations. And I was always asking her, can I take a look at the wave function? And she never said that I could take a look at the wave function. So I thought, what's that? And then finally, she confessed that the output of the calculation were 1,000 A4 pages. And that the largest components, I think, in the wave functions were a few percent or something. But there were several. So it means that these wave functions of large-scale shell model calculations you cannot read in your lifetime to the end. Yeah? So you, in order to provide understanding in complex situations, you have to try to make sense of it. And this is often by using these simpler symmetry-based models. Of course, at the end, you would like to have the large-scale shell model answer also to compare with the data. But then the interpretation goes easier if you have these simpler models. And in fact, people doing very difficult theoretical calculations with density formalism or large-scale shell models, over a coffee, they agree that they also use the language of the simpler models in order to interpret their results. They urge experimentators to adopt new approaches in order to get the unreachable but crucial while robust numbers. So this is one example is in Norbert Pietralas' lecture. There were these predictions of mixed symmetry states, and nobody had observed them. So till Achim Richter in 1984 observed the first 1 plus mixed symmetry state. The gold 196 case is also an example where you really, as experimentalist, have to use the best methods in order to extract crucial experimental observations. They should be provided a solid microscopic foundation by comparing their predictions with those of more microscopically funded models. Here also, I discussed two possibilities to determine the parameters from a microscopic basis. One was to use the shell model and to do a mapping on the interacting boson model. So then your parameters come from a shell model calculation, but you can only do that in spherical nuclei. If you have deformed nuclei, then there is new on the market and available here in Ganil. Another method elaborated by Kosuke Nomura from Tokyo. So you use the density formula or Skirm interactions. They calculate these potential energy surfaces, and then you fit, or you calculate in the IBM, two also potential energy surfaces, and you fit them to each other until they fit, and then you have the advantage that in the IBM, everything is coupled to good particle number, good angular momentum, and so on. So you get immediately the excitation spectrum and the transition rates and so on, which is difficult in the other formalism to attain. So new symmetries like supersymmetry may offer even new ways to unify our understanding of nuclei. Now, summary of symmetries over the years. Immediately after the discovery of the neutron, Heisenberg proposed isospin, which relates the proton to the neutron, and say it's just a nucleon with an isospin 1/2 up and down. Wigner, in 1936, extended this isospin to a spin-isospin combination, SU4, in which you have now a considering of a higher symmetry in order to unify the nuclear forces. In 1947, Racah introduced seniority, or introduced the description of pairing. So we saw that seniority has to do with the number of, for instance, D bosons not paired to zero. In 1948, Meyer and Gubert Meyer and Jensen introduced the spherical shell model, which also has a lot of dynamical symmetries in it, which are used. Then in 1952, Bohr and Mottelson introduced the collective model, which has these octahedral symmetries, these reflection symmetries. So it's not dynamical symmetries, but kind of reflection symmetries, but also the Wigner-Day matrices are related to angular momentum. In 1958, I don't know whether Pete talked about it, there was a big step forward because the shell model and the collective model were opponents. On Monday. And then Elliot showed that you can get rotational spectra in a pure shell model calculation. So you get a connection that shell model and collective model are not opponents, they are somehow related. But Pete will discuss that on Monday. Then what I discussed was from 1974 on the interacting boson approximation, where you replace paired nucleons by bosons, S and D, and you have extensions, which I mentioned. Then in 1980, Franco Iacchello introduced supersymmetry in dynamical supersymmetry to describe even and odd A nuclei on an equal basis. Finally, I wrote a popular description of this lost story, which appeared in Scientific American in 2002. For the German, you have a German translation of this article in Spectrum der Wissenschaften, and so you might want to take a look at it. It appeared in 17 other languages, so probably in your language. I have a Japanese version, at least. So the funny thing is, the designer, so you work with professional designers, and so explaining them what we do, that we have neutrons and protons, and we transform them, and we connect them, and they are unconnected systems. And so he came up with this picture. So this is platinum 196. This is an apple. And then you have an orange. That's an odd A nucleus, and another golden orange. Yeah? And a platinum orange and a golden orange. Here you see the gold. And so you transform them. Because there is an American saying, nothing compares so like apples and pears. Apples and oranges. But in German, the saying, if you translate it, it's not apples and oranges, but it's apples and pears. And so they changed the cover and made it apples. Apples in birnen.
What's it in
Japanese? No, that's... No, I discussed it. It's something like earth and heaven, isn't it? Not two things are so different as earth and heaven in Japanese. Yeah. If you say things are different like apples and oranges in English. You know this saying? They are very different, it means. I was told that in Japan you would say nothing is as different as earth and heaven. No? Anyhow. Maybe it was in Russian, or I mean. So, again, I will distribute the slides, so they will be available today. And also, at the end of the afternoon, we will distribute the exercises and their solutions. Yeah. So with this, I would like to conclude the lecture. Remember, I tried. Unfortunately, you cannot download here the Springer book, our Springer book. You cannot. This on symmetries in atomic nuclei. But I guess Pete has all the PDF files. So I of the book, yeah. Also, I have to look. Maybe I can give you the PDF files of the book, so that you can place them on. It's an internal website. Or no. But most institutes have access directly to the book over the link. Maybe we don't have access because we are kind of visitors. Maybe you have.